Hello everyone. So in this video, I want to talk about something very important. It's actually the different stages of compilation. So till now, what we've done is basically just something like this. We did a first program.c, and we just had a first program.exe or a .out as the output. But the .exe is just the final output that we get. There are actually a lot of stages to converting a C program to a executable file. So the first step in this is something called preprocessing, and preprocessing doesn't really do much. It just so this thing right here, anything that starts with a pound symbol is actually called a preprocessing directive. And so this hash include is a preprocessing directive. And what's going to happen is in the preprocessing step itself, this single line right here is going to be replaced by the entire contents of this stdio file. So let's just do the preprocessing once and then you'll understand this better. So the way to do preprocessing is to use the dash E flag, uppercase E here, and then let's just give it first program.c, and what I want as output is a first program.i. So a .i file is a preprocessed C program. So that's what I want as the output for this command. Let me hit enter. And as you can see, I've got a .i file here. Let me just open this once. And you'll see that this file is really, really long. And the reason for that is because this one single statement right here has been converted to a lot of lines. So let me just skip all of this and scroll down to the very end. And as you can see, we have our program intact here. So that's the pre-processing stage. And at this point, I also want to talk about something called a pre-processing, something called a macro. So let's just go to something like, let's say, variables.c. And here, let's say I want, let's do the pre-processing for this one. It's variables.c, and I want as the output variables.i. So let's open this variables.i, and let's scroll to the bottom. So as you can see here, these x and c remain as they are. So that's basically just our program with absolutely no changes at all. But let's say I wanted to use in my program some constant value like pi. So what I can do is say float pi equals 3.14 whatever 15 thing. So what I can actually do this, but there are actually a lot of risks to this. The first risk is that someone might actually accidentally just change the value of pi. Let's say I was trying to do some operation which used pi and instead just happened to assign a different value into pi. So that's not a great idea. So another thing is, let's just say I don't use this at all, and when I'm actually calculating some, let's say, circumference, I say 2 into 3.14 into r. So I've just used pi here, but someone who's reading the program for the first time may not know why you use this 3.14 here. Obviously, in this case, it's pretty obvious, but let's say you were doing something like rupee to dollar conversion or something, and you used a random 72 point something value there. then someone might not understand why that value is there. So what we can do is we can actually just say hash define, then say pi, and then just write 3.14 here. And let's just first try compiling this program to see if this actually works all right. And as you can see, it compiles fine, so I am perfectly allowed to do this. So in my program now, all I have to do is just replace, let's say I'm calculating circumference wherever I want to use pi. I just write pi there and then I multiply it by the radius, or whatever I want to do. I can actually make these kinds of constants here. So these right here are known as macros, and it's a common practice to use full uppercase for macros. So if I was doing something like dollar to rupee, I would do something like this or whatever. But basically we use full caps with underscores in it. So this actually also has another advantage. So what happens when we use a variable is that whenever we are using the variable, the part of memory where this variable is actually kept is going to be accessed over and over again. But it's not the same with macros. And the way I'm going to show you is I'm going to actually do the pre-compilation, the pre-processing step here. And let's just open it again and let's scroll to the bottom where our program actually is. Alright, so I haven't used pi anywhere, so let's just do int y equals pi times x, and let's just do the pre-processing now. And let's just see what has happened. So as you can see here, I don't have a pi here, which I have right here. It has already been converted to 3.14. So that's another advantage of using a macro. It's not actually when the program is running that the macro is accessed again and again. It's actually at the pre-processing step itself that all instances of that macro are just going to be changed to whatever the value I've given. So that's another thing that I wanted to show about pre-processing. And the next step is actually the compilation step. And the way to do that is we use the dash s flag. And let's just do this for, let's say, our switch case, dot c dash o, and the output that I want for this one is a dot s file, a small s, a lowercase s here. So now what I've got here is a switch case dot s, and if I open this, this is actually something called assembly code. And don't worry, you don't need to be able to read all of this right now, but I can just show you a few things. So as you can see, this LC0, let me just open my switch case program as well. So here it's case 0 is n is 0, and case 1 is n is 1, all of that. So let's just see here. So as you can see, this LC0 just stands for printing the first message, this one. And then LC1 is for accepting the value from the user. LC2 is our case 0. LC3 is our case 1. And LC4 is our default. And this is the main of our program. So here, what you can see is it does an LC0 here. It does an LC1 here. So LC0 is printing the message. LC1 is accepting user input, and then it's actually doing something like it's going into L3 at some point. So we've got L3, L4, L7, all of these here, and it's from within L3 that it goes to LC2, from within L4 it goes to LC3, and from within L7 it goes to LC4. So if you see right here, we are going to L3, but we're actually going to L3 on a condition. This JE right here stands for jump if equal, and this JMP is just an unconditional jump. So if it's JE, we are only doing this if some equality matches. Don't worry about what it is right now, but it goes here, and from here it goes to a jump to L5, and L5 basically just stops our program. All of this is assembly level code, and you don't need to be able to read all of this right now, but it's good to have a basic understanding. And another thing that I want to point out here is that this is actually readable. So all of this can be read by a human, and he or she can figure out what the program is, how it's doing stuff. So that's the compilation step. The next step is called assembly, and the assembly step is done using the -c flag. So I can write switch case dot c, and the output that I want is a switch case dot o file here. So the dot o here stands for an object file, and an object file, I can't actually see it here. The reason for that is because object files are not readable. So if I actually go into my folder, I have my object file right here, and I can say open with Sublime Text, but this is the kind of thing that I'm going to get here, so I'm not going to be able to read any of this. And one very important use for an object file is, let's say someone asked me to write a program and I want to give him the program, but I don't want him to be able to access the code, because if he accesses the code, he can just play around with it, change things in there. So I don't want him to be able to do that. So I would just give him the object file, and he can use the object file however he wants, but he's not going to be able to get the source code or the C program from the object file. Although there might be ways to do it now, but as a general rule, it's not readable, and that's one very important use for it. And the last step that I want to talk about is the linking step, which actually gets us our executable file. So this, as you know, is just switch case dot c dash o switch case dot exe, and that gives us the dot exe file. And if you've noticed, I've everywhere just used this .c file as the input to the command, but I can actually use files that are being created in various steps. So what I can do is do something like gcc-s variables.i and then -o variables.s. So this is perfectly valid too. I can do that. I can use the dot o file for as the input for the compilation step. So I can do that for other cases as well, but I think this gives you the general idea, and these are extensions that you should remember. These are things that are really important to understand how the system works behind the scenes. So I just wanted to point this out, and I think this video has already gone too long. So I'll see you next time.